Welcome and welcome back to my channel, you guys. I am so happy you're here because for today's video, I'm going to be focusing on the one and only book talk sensation book, Powerless by Lauren Roberts. I'm super excited about this because this would probably be like my third fantasy read at this point. However, everybody's raving about this book. This book has been everywhere since it came out. I'm really excited to read Powerless and let you know my thoughts. Because if you didn't notice, the other thing that's on the title of this video, it's actually that I'll be doing a spoiler section for this book. It'll actually be, you know, my first time doing all these things in a video. If you have not read this book or are starting to read this book, please skip over the spoilers if you don't want to ruin anything for yourself. But as always, I'm super excited to get started on this video. I'm super excited to just get into this book. The other reason why I decided to read this book and do a whole video on it is because this is the book of the month for the Discord channel. I'm just really excited to dedicate a whole video to this book in particular, just because of the sensation around it. Like, everybody's talking about it, everybody's reading it, and of course, to my fellow Discord mates, this video is also going to be for you guys. I hope that you guys enjoy this video and I hope that you guys get some good reactions. Also, don't spoil anything for yourself, you guys. Like, if you have not read this book and you want to read it or you're planning on reading it, please skip over the spoiler sections. I'm just telling you now because, you know, I don't like spoiling things for myself and I don't like spoiling things for other people. So, enter at your own risk, right? It is October. Yeah, let's get right into it. I have my drink here. It's a grape poppy. If you guys have not tried poppy drinks, this is not sponsored, by the way. If you guys have not tried these, you must try them because they're so good. First time I'm trying the grape flavor, and it tastes very similar to like Fanta, grape Fanta. If you guys have ever had grape Fanta, shout out to you guys. This is exactly what it tastes like. So I'm actually annotating Powerless. I'm like, I want to say like 14% through the book. Very similar to Hunger Games. If you guys have ever like watched the Hunger Games or read the Hunger Games like series, it's very, very similar to that. But the characters are completely different. I love how some characters have like quirky hair or like distinctive features that make them stand out. Kai, dark hair, green eyes, fit, tall. I'm sick. I have a terrible sore throat. My nose is a little runny. But we're outside today because the weather's great, so I wanted to read outdoors for a bit. I literally just read. It's literally a sentence. It's dialogue. And tell me how the fact that this man said this, I'm literally passing out from like the intensity. Not the intensity, but yes, the intensity, because it's an intense situation right now. She's like in and out of consciousness. And he literally says, "Remind me to make you smile like that again when you aren't dying. And I have all the time in the world to memorize it."
the way I literally passed out. This man isn't even real. This is a fictional man. This man does not exist. Or so I don't think he does. But if you're a real life Kai and you're out there,
for a moment, chapter 35 is giving what it needs to give. The tension is accumulated on chapter 35. Okay, what is this book? Okay, I want to see if I can put a dent in this book. I think I'm about like 52% through the book so far. Nothing has really happened yet. Like, they're just, again, tension building. It's literally been 300 pages of tension building, 300 of them. At this point, this book is torture. 321 pages in, it's torture. I want my very own Kai. So there's 68 chapters and then an epilogue. I'm almost there. Like, what, 12 more chapters? Tell me this girl's not falling for him. I have so much self-control. Like, if I was her, don't start. Can't even eat my cookies in peace. There's so much going on right now. At this point in this story, I'm concerned for my well-being. Literally this far in the book, I'm in shambles. I'm gripping for my life at this point. This girl has so much self-control. I don't even have words for the things that I'm reading at this point. It's now day 500,353. No idea what day it is, you guys. But I think I've been reading this book for a solid week. If I'm not mistaken, I started this book last Saturday and today is Friday. I have like this much left of the book and it's a pretty solid chunk. I'm planning on finishing it all today just because this book is so, honestly, this book is so good. The tension, the banter, the action, like the mystical, fantastical elements are just, I'm eating it up. Like, if this is what romanticy is like, sign me up. Whatever, wherever it is that I can get more of these books, sign me up. If you have any romanticy recommendations, please put them down below, because after reading Powerless, I have no words, none at all. I'm still sick. If you guys haven't noticed, my nose is like a little red. I've been blowing my nose all day today, coughing, sneezing, just, you know, the basics. This is how you know that you're comfortable with someone. It says, this is like no context, but I'm sure like those that are watching this and have read this book know exactly what I'm talking about. There's this scene where Kai is basically having a nightmare and Peyton kind of like wakes him up from the nightmare and he gets scared and he kind of like nicks her neck and he like wants to braid her hair. Again, we forgot that part, but he wants to braid her hair again. The line says, "We both still content to let the silence stretch between us." And I don't know, like, that's when you know that you're comfortable with someone. And that's when you know that, like, there's vulnerability there, because you're letting the person that you're sitting in silence with see you as, like, your truest self. Like, your most calm, most natural self, and you can just be with someone, like just exist with someone, and you don't necessarily have to be doing the same activity. But I don't know, there's something so vulnerable and something so revealing and almost like beautiful about moments like that, where you can just sit with someone in silence and it's not like awkward. It makes you feel comfortable and safe and just like appreciated, because you're sharing quality time with this other person who also likes sharing quality time with you. And it doesn't necessarily have to be like with them having conversation with you or with them like entertaining you in any way. Like, you guys are just both coexisting in the same space without words, and nonverbal communication is where it's at. I wish I was a nonverbal communication expert. I am well versed in the nonverbal communication world. Like, I can tell when someone's uncomfortable, I can tell when someone's comfortable, I can understand when someone's like feeling anxious or frustrated or sad. Like, I can see those cues just because I feel like I'm more observant than the average person. And it's happened to me before in like many conversations where like I'll just meet someone for the first time, second time, you know, like a stranger, right? And I'll come across this person and we'll just have conversation, and we'll kind of just randomly get into like the deeper aspects of who we are, you know. Forget the what's your favorite color, where are you from, blah blah blah. It'll get deep real quick. Not real quick, but it'll get deep, and before we know it, like, we're just like talking about stuff, we're actually having conversation. And it's happened to me where people kind of like have to pause and they're like, I don't even know why I'm telling you this. But then they continue to tell me anyway. So I don't know if it's just me, like, as a person. And let me know if you guys experience this as well. But I don't know. It's happened to me a couple of times. And it's just nice to hear during conversation when someone says, like, oh, I really appreciate talking to you. Or I feel comfortable telling you this. Or, like, I trust you with this. Or, you know, like, I know that you won't say anything to anyone. Like, I don't know, there's just such a good feeling and also responsibility, I feel like, that comes with having people trust you in that way. Whether I just meet the person like that same day in a matter of hours, or if I've known the person for a much longer period of time, there's something so special that connects people when you can have genuine conversations and get deep, but also get real.
This book is so annoying.
I don't want to read this book anymore. How did I know it was going to be her? What is happening in this book? He figured it out. Oh my gosh. Final page in this book. Oh my goodness. Hi everybody. We have arrived at the saddest point in this video. I've finished Powerless. It's done. I did it. I got through it. Words. Let's see. I didn't even take notes while I was reading this book. I was kind of like mentally jotting down things that I knew I wanted to cover. But before I do that, I do want to put my final review on Goodreads. This is going to be the start of the spoiler section. So if you have not read this book, or if you're reading it and you have not finished this book, please pause it here and then come back to see what I think about this book, because I am going to be spoiling it. I am going to be mentioning a lot of the things that happen in this book and going over them and giving my interpretation of it. If you guys are ending the video here, thank you for watching this far, and I really encourage you to finish Powerless because it was such a great read. It was so entertaining, and I loved it. Good luck with your read, and I hope to see you again soon. Welcome to the second half of this video, and it is purely going to be spoilers about Powerless, because we have a lot to get into, we have a lot to talk about, but I want to condense as much of it as possible. Starting off, the first kind of like thing that irked me about this book was the fact that Kai and Peyton had such a high, intense, they just had like so much chemistry, so much like tension, their interactions, like they were all so close to leading to other things. I'm so disappointed that we didn't even get a kiss, y'all. Like, we did not even get a single peck. We got, okay, on page 432 is when we get them finally about to kiss, but the only thing that we get is that their lips brush together. At this point, they slept together, okay, but not in that way. They just literally sleep together, like they're spooning each other and they're sleeping. He like checks her out. She's always thinking about him. Like, at one point in the book, like, she admits to liking him to Adina. Like, I loved, this book is pure tension. This book is like not only character development, because there was huge character development in this book. Like, I thoroughly enjoyed seeing like the beginning of Peyton and seeing her now, and then seeing the beginning of Kai and then seeing him now at the end of the book. However, the book was purely tension building. It was enemies to lovers, back to enemies. It was close proximity. There was a little bit of a love triangle between Kit and Kai and Peyton. So you have these two brothers, and then they're both vying for Peyton, but in very different ways. Like, Kit is very like forthcoming, he's very kind, he's very straightforward with Peyton, and he's like, hey, like, I want to take you to the ball, this and that, whatever, blah blah, great, we love that. Peyton, she's obviously coming into these trials with a purpose, right? Like, she does not like the king. She's like, you killed my father, and I hate you, basically. Like, she has pure hatred for this king. But she does like his children, which are Kai and Kit. So we get like a little bit of a love triangle. At first I was like, oh no, this is bad, because we're gonna have like a really big brawl between the brothers. Like, the brothers are gonna go like head to head. Thankfully that doesn't happen. Thankfully, like, she never has any feelings for Kit, but she does feel some sort of like apprehension about him. And then at the end, like towards the end of the book, when they're like kind of solidifying more of their relationship, she feels like more comfort, and she feels that he's more caring and that he's different from the king. We see her have that realization, and we see her kind of feel for the both of them in different ways. The entire storyline is basically like just Kai and Peyton, like, just always there, you know? Like, they're always on each other's minds, they're always like just like there together. Somehow they're always around each other. So thankfully the love triangle thing kind of faded, and I was like, okay, we're good. Like, there's no love triangle. We love that. One thing that I really loved is like how she was very comfortable living in both worlds. Like, she was very comfortable living in the worlds of the elites, And she was also very comfortable living in the world of the ordinaries. And this is just me speculating. This is just me, like, kind of like throwing this out there. I don't know if this is actually what's gonna happen. I don't know. My speculation is that at the end, when she basically defeats the king, she like throws the dagger at his throat, he's dead, gone, and then Kai basically banishes her and says, like, I don't even know what he says, but he said this. He said, "At least you kept your promise. You stayed alive long enough to stab me in the back." He laughs bitterly, remembering the attack after the first ball when I tended to his wound. "And now I promise to return the favor." His voice strains with emotion. "Run, Payton, because when I catch you, I will not miss. I will not falter. I will not make the mistake of feeling for you." So after all of this happens, she already has the little O that the king kind of like engraved in her, like branded her with, because she's an ordinary. But I have this feeling that she's kind of mixed, like she's a mix of both. She's like a hybrid, but she doesn't know it yet. And I think either in the second or the third book, because I know it's like a trilogy from what I read, it's a trilogy. In either one of those books, I'm hoping that we get like this realization where she's like, oh, I have powers. And then she kind of like trains and learns how to use it and all of that. But that's just me speculating. Like, I don't know if this is actually true, if this is actually something that is like actually going to happen. I don't know. That was just me thinking about it, because there's a point as well in the book, like after the acknowledgments, we get like a little sneak peek, and she says something like, so I don't know if this is like a play on words or if this is like just what it is, like literal, but it says, "A reminder, a representation of what I am, or rather what I'm not. Oh, for ordinary." I don't know if that's foreshadowing. I don't know if that means that she's not ordinary. I don't know. Maybe I'm reading too much into that, but that was something else that I was like, we could be heading some sort of way in this book. Another thing, the king, off with his head. Like, I'm done with the king. I could not stand him with his little like I'm so happy that he's gone. I'm so happy that we don't have to deal with this king anymore. I am, though, I'm intrigued about what's going to happen in the next book when we have Kit and Kai and Payton all in the same room. Obviously, it has to happen. Like, obviously, at one point, she's gonna be captured by Kai, the enforcer. Also, the guy who's, like, obsessed with her. And be taken back to the castle where Kit is now king. The other thing was Blair. Blair was like the ultimate villain. Like, we can talk about the king being a villain and we're like, yeah, great, like we all knew that he was evil, but Blair, a part of me is kind of like upset that she survived the trials. The audacity that she had to kill Adina right in front of Payton in that last trial. It's that I don't understand. I get it. But at the same time, I don't understand how Payton didn't just like get up and like fight with all her might to beat this girl up. Or maybe even like, because Blair just reminds me of one of those like spoiled, entitled girls that think that like all the guys like her, that, you know, the attention's all on her, and like, oh, look at me, like I'm so cool, so powerful, whatever. Like, no, go away. So this is my problem. I knew when they said, because I think there was a point before the trial that the king told her, like, oh, you're not gonna win these trials, like, I assure you. And she was like, bet, like, I'm totally gonna win. At this point, we already knew about the resistance. They had already planned to like infiltrate the bowl during the last trial and like take over the elites and all of that. We do have Lenny, who was an imperial and was actually the imperial that was assigned to Payton. But little did we know, until we find out about the resistance through Payton's point of view, that Lenny, you know, is part of it as well. So they kind of work together within the castle. They're like the eyes and ears of the castle. since they are the ones that are in there, and then they kind of distribute the information to the resistance members outside in Loot, which is where Peyton's from. I was so nervous because when the last trial was announced and they were all like kind of in the bowl waiting to start the maze and everything, someone said like at the center you'll find something or someone, and then you have to like kill that thing or like end that thing to win or something like that. I can't remember the exact words. My mind straight went to either Lenny or Adina. Why? Because those are the two most important people in Peyton's life. Adina, ride or die, like that's her girl, that's her best friend, her sister, like they're like this, literally like this. And Lenny, of course, because Lenny, maybe they found out, like an Imperial found out, snitched on him, whatever, and then they were just like, you know, gonna trick him. Guys, the way I sobbed when it was revealed that Adina was in the middle of that maze, I was literally in tears. When Adina died, when Adina was killed by Blair, which Blair, we're coming for you, Blair. There's an army just for you. That's just coming for you after what you did to Adina. I was literally losing my mind as I was reading this. Because chapter 54 on, chaos. All that ensues is chaos. We get death, we get trials, we get sword fights, we get power fights, everything in these last few pages of this book. Like every time I read a sentence about Adina post her death, why would they do this to Adina? Like, man, you could have spared her. You could have at least used her in the second book. Like, why take away the one person that she trusted the most in this world? The one person that she had. The one soul that she could bear her whole self to. Brutal. Absolutely brutal. I was very sad about Adina. Like, I'm not gonna lie, I loved their friendship. I loved how happy they were once like Peyton went to go get her in Loot and she was like, hey, you're coming back with me because you're gonna be my personal seamstress. And I don't know, like I was just so happy. Like I was literally laughing. I was like, oh my god, this is so great, they're gonna be together. When I tell you, like, the last chapters of this book ripped my heart out. First of all, we don't know who survived in the resistance once they infiltrated the bowl in the last trial, because after Adina died and they had like their super sad moment, she kind of just like left her there, and like not just left her there, obviously, you know, she was sad, but she couldn't carry her and like run with her, so she kind of just like left her there. Sadly, we don't know who survives. We don't know if any of the resistance members that she met with survived at all, like Mina, Callum, Lenny. Like, we have no idea. We have no idea. She has no idea. Adina gone, her father obviously gone. Who does she have left? Kai? She's completely alone in the world, and that makes me so sad for her. Overall, I thoroughly enjoyed this book. I love reading in Kai's point of view. Every time I read from Kai's point of view, I was like, do men actually think like this? Like, if a man sees me sleeping, are they gonna be like, oh, she's a messy masterpiece, she looks so beautiful with her tousled hair and her 28 freckles? Like, I don't even have freckles. Listen, whoever she modeled Kai after, I want to meet him. Dare I say that Kai is probably my new book boyfriend. Definitely my new book boyfriend. And I'm not afraid to say it. I thoroughly enjoyed this book. I'm giving this book a 4 stars. I'm looking forward to the next books. But if you are interested in reading this book, please read it. Do yourself a favor, because you're gonna pass out every single time. Shout out to the Discord channel that I joined, because I am so looking forward to talking about this book with you guys. I'm looking forward to hear your opinions, to hear what you guys have to say as well. That concludes the end of this video, you guys. Thank you so much for watching this video. I thoroughly enjoyed reading Powerless. I would highly recommend this book to anybody who's interested in reading it. It's a solid read, so much fun, so much tension, so much action. If you guys enjoyed this video, please comment, like, and subscribe whenever you have a chance. And as always, I'll see you in the next video. Peace.